Hello dear friends, I Prof.Aagam Dalal on behalf of JK Shah classes welcomes you in this inter DT November 2023 RTP discussion. A good kind of RTP they have prepared this time. Not too difficult, not too easy. Some of the topics which are not covered normally in the module they have tried to cover over here. Now let us go one by one. I'll just quickly revise the points which are covered in that and we'll discuss the answers accordingly. First of all, the very first case scenario. Now, whenever any total income kind of question you can see in any kind of MCQ, you always first start solving the entire sum. You first calculate total income because then the MCQs will be based on that only. That what is the total income, what is total deduction, what is tax payable, etc. So, whenever you can see any kind of question which looks like total income ka question, start calculating total income. Mr. Shan, a resident aged 42 years, employed in MNC in Gurugram, since 2013. He submitted his resignation on 31st July 22 for starting his own business and gave a notice period of 1 month to employer. Means he is actually resigning from 31st August, but he gave this resignation on 31st July. He received the following emolument from his employer from April till August. So basically what will happen is April, May, June, July, August, 5 months only he will receive the salary, because from 31st August then onward he is starting his own business. His basic salary 45,000 per month. So for 5 months, I have just computed over here in some rough kind of work, 45,000 into 5, so basic salary will become 2,25,000. Dearness allowance, which is 100% forming part of retirement benefit, is 10% of basic salary. So obviously if my basic salary is 225, the DA will become 22,500, that is 10% of basic salary. Medical allowance is 5,000 per month. So for 5 months, how much it will be taxable? Fully 25,000. As we all know, medical allowance is fully taxable. Entertainment allowance, 2,500 per month. Even entertainment allowance is fully taxable. Regarding that, a deduction is available in 16 clause 2, but the deduction is available only if you are government employee. This person is not a government employee, so that deduction will also not be available. So entertainment allowance 2,500 per month. So in accordance with 5 months, it will be 12,500. Commission 10,000 per month. If nothing is said, this is fixed commission. 10,000 into 5, 50,000 is what? Taxable. Then what they have written? Employee contribution to RPF 7,500 per month. Now understand, whatever employee is contributing in recognized provident fund, that employee contribution is not an income, it is already included in basic salary. This is a deduction under section 80C and that comes after gross total income. So this we will keep pending for section 80C. Employer contributed in the same amount of to RPF. So again, the same amount is contributed by employer also. Now for employer contribution, how much is the exemption? It is 12% of salary or 7,50,000 per annum, whichever is lower. Here 7,50,000 is so too high amount. So the only condition is 12% of salary. What comes under salary? Basic. Plus only that DA which is percentage of retirement benefit. Plus only that commission which is percentage of turnover, which in this case it is not there. Basic and DA is there. How much is my basic salary? 2,25,000 and my DA is 22,500. So if I do the total, that 2,25,000 plus 22,500, that comes to 2,47,500. And of that, 12% exemption will be given. 12% will become 29,700. My employer is contributing 7,500 per month. So for 5 months, he is contributing 37,500. Exemption is 29,700. Balance 7,800 will be taxable in my salary. Interest accrued in the RPF at the rate 13% is 14,300. Exemption is only if it is up to 9.5%. So if I am getting 14,300, how much will I get if the interest rate what has 9.5%? It will be 10,450. So taxable will be 3,850. Further, my gross salary comes to 3,46,650. Now question is, this person is opting 115 BAC or remaining in old regime? In the last line they have said he does not opt for 115 BAC. So I can definitely claim 50,000 ka standard deduction. Please don't forget that 16 clause 1A standard deduction of 50,000. So my total salary is now 296,650. Now further, in October 22, he started the business of manufacturing of footwear under the brand name Comfort. He withdrew the entire amount from his RPF in September 2022 to invest in his business. Now when the RPF ki maturity becomes taxable? It becomes taxable if you withdraw before 5 years. You have joined the company in 2013. You are withdrawing the amount in 2022. Obviously you are withdrawing after 5 years. This RPF maturity is completely exempt. He has employed 75 regular employees on 1st November 22 at a basic salary 23,000 per month. Even they participate in recognized provident fund also. Means they are regular employee, not casual employees. Why they have given us the information regarding additional employees? So you must be aware, the deduction is there 80JJAA. If you are audited person under section 44AB, you are employing additional employees. And those additional employees are working for more than 240 days in the year. But in the case of manufacturing of apparels, footwear, leather product, this 140 days is replaced with 150 days. In this case, our business is manufacturing of footwear. So the employees, if they are working for more than 150 days, then also they will be eligible employee. And if their salary is not more than 25,000 per month, in this example, the salary is 23,000 per month. They are eligible employee for claiming 80JJAA ka deduction. How much is the deduction of 80JJAA? 30% of additional employee cost. What is my additional employee cost in this example? See, first of all, the employees are employed on 1st November. So November 30 days, December, January, February, 28 plus 31 days of March. That becomes 151 days more than 150 days. And as the business is of manufacturing of footwear, more than 150 days. Salary is less than 25,000 per month and they are participating in recognized provident fund. They are not casual workers. Further, the turnover of the company is 7 crore. 12% is received in cash. More than 5% turnover received in cash. Means the audit is applicable if turnover is more than 1 crore. Turnover is 7 crore. You are audited under 44AB also. All the condition of 80JJAA satisfied. You are audited. Additional employee are hired, they are working for more than 150 days, salary is not more than 25,000 per month, they are not casual employees also, whatever is the salary for the year 22-23, of that 30% is allowed as a deduction of 80JJAA. Now what is the speciality of 80JJAA? If you claim 80JJAA, even you are in old regime, even you are in 115 BAC, in both you can claim that deduction. But if you are in old regime, and you are claiming 80JJAA ka deduction, to you one more concept is applicable called alternate minimum tax. Please keep that in your mind. Here the person is following old system and he will be claiming 80JJAA ka deduction. To him, normal tax payable is applicable, along with that alternate minimum tax is also applicable, that we'll see later on. As of now, let's just decide what is the amount of 80JJAA. How much additional employees? So 75. How much is their salary? 23,000. How much month they have worked for? 5 months. So what is the total additional employee cost? It comes to 86,25,000. Of that 30% deduction I can get. So 30% is what? 25,87,500. So 80JJAA ka deduction 25,87,500. And remember that employee contribution, I said it is allowed as a deduction in 80C. So in 80C also employee contribution 37,500. Now what is the PGBP income? They said PGBP income is computed 51 lakh. Computed meaning thereby all the deduction is already given effect of. Even the salary expense is already deducted. 51 lakh is my PGBP income, which I will add over here PGBP 51 lakh. Then on 1st December 2022, he has purchased a house property for rupees 90 lakh for self-occupation by taking a loan of 45 lakh at the rate of 10% on the same day. He has paid the stamp duty of 6,25,000 on purchase of the said house property. First of all, if you are paying any interest on the loan, which is SOP, if it is old regime, SOP ka interest is allowed as a deduction. If it is 115 BAC, SOP ka interest is not allowed as a deduction. Now here to we are following old system. If it is a self-occupied property, my net annual value is always zero. But what I can deduct? Interest. How much interest I would have paid? 45 lakh into 10% into how many month? Only 4 month, because the loan is taken in December month. So 45 lakh into 10% into 4 divided by 12. How much interest? 1,50,000. As loan is taken on or after 1st April 1999, purchase is completed on the same day of loan taken, 2 lakh rupees is the limit under 24 clause B. But I have paid interest only 1,50,000. So how much house property loss I can deduct? 1,50,000. This is the interest, because of that loss is generated. This loss I can set off against any other head, even including salary. So I have deducted 1,50,000 interest. My gross total income comes to 52,46,650. But please remember, whatever stamp duty you are paying for the new residential house property, it is allowed as a deduction in ATC. So 6,25,000 is allowed as a deduction in ATC as stamp duty expense. Acha, whatever is the principal repayment of the loan, even that principal repayment of the loan is also allowed as a deduction. But they have said nothing about principal repayment, so I can't assume anything. My ATC deduction will be restricted to 1,50,000. ATJJAA I have already taken. My total income comes to 25,09,150. Now, let us calculate tax payable, then we'll see what they have actually asked. On 25,09,150, I have to calculate two kind of tax. One is my normal tax, and one I have to calculate alternate minimum tax, because I have claimed. See, when AMT is applicable, when you are claiming either 10AA or 35AD, or for your syllabus only I am saying 80QQB, 80RRB, 80JJAA. You are claiming 80JJAA. You are having old system. That's why alternate minimum tax is applicable. So I have to calculate two kind of tax, and what I will pay ultimately, whichever is higher. But alternate minimum tax is applicable only if your adjusted total income is more than 20 lakh. What is adjusted total income? It is total income plus add back those deduction which you have claimed, because of which AMT is applicable. So total income is 25,09,150 plus I will add 80JJAA ka deduction. Obviously it is more than 25 lakh, 20 lakhs I mean. And that's why AMT concept is applicable. So finally I will pay the tax, normal tax or AMT, whichever is higher. Now on 25,09,150, I have to calculate my normal tax, which will be applying by slab rate. I am a resident, but I am not a senior citizen. So above 10 lakh 30% up to 10 lakh 1,12,500 plus 4% cess. So my tax rounded off is 587,860, but this is as per normal tax liability. No TDS is deducted, so I don't have to deduct anything further. Rounding off is must. But now I have to calculate what is my adjusted total income. It is the total income plus 80JJAA deduction in this case. So my adjusted total income comes to 50,96,650. On that, what is the rate of AMT? Directly 18.5%. It is an alternate tax system. Directly 18.5%. So that is the basic tax. But can I say my adjusted total income is more than 50 lakh? So surcharge at the rate of 10% is also applicable. So I will add 10% surcharge. After adding 10% surcharge, it will be 10,37,168. However, as my adjusted total income is very near to the threshold of surcharge, surcharge kya threshold is 50 lakh, adjusted total income is having only a gap of 96,650. Marginal relief can come. Even in AMT, marginal relief can come. Now, if over here marginal relief will come, what I have to see? If my adjusted total income would have been exactly 50 lakh, what will be the tax payable? If it would have been exactly 50 lakh, then my tax would have been 18.5%. No surcharge has to be added. Acha, cess is not to be added. Marginal relief is before health and education cess. So here my tax would have been 9,25,000. Correct? But today my income is 50,96,650, on which 10% surcharge is applicable. So now my tax is coming to 10,37,168. Now you can closely observe how much income has increased, 96,650. But how much tax has increased over here? So 9,25,000 and 10,37,168. The difference is 1,12,168. How much tax has increased more than difference of income? It has increased 15,518. That is marginal relief. I will deduct that marginal relief. So what tax is payable now? 1021,650. On that finally I will add 4% health and education cess. Now my tax will become 1,062,520. So please understand, even if while calculating normal tax payable surcharge is not there, marginal relief is not there, AMT calculation is separate. In that separately you have to see the limit of surcharge, separately you have to see the marginal relief. And while calculating marginal relief in alternate minimum tax, whatever is the threshold, on that also you have to apply alternate minimum tax. Now based on this, let us solve the MCQs which they have asked. What is the amount of salary chargeable under the head salary? So what is my salary ka income? We have calculated 296,650. 296,650. The option has to be C. Yes, it is C. Then what is the total amount of deduction available to Mr. Shan under chapter 6A? So what is the total deduction of chapter 6A ka deduction? This 1,50,080 C plus 25,87,500, that is 80JJAA. Total is 27,37,500. The option has to be D. Yes. Then, what is the total income of Mr. Shan? So, what is the total income we have calculated? 25,9,150. Answer is A. Compute the tax liability of Mr. Shan. So, see, my normal tax is 587,860. My AMT is 1062,520. Whichever is higher, 1062,520. That much I have to pay. So tax payable is 1062,520. Option has to be C. But understand one thing. Whatever tax I have paid in excess compared to my normal tax, that much is called as AMT credit, which will be carry forwarded for the next year and which I can deduct in any of the future year in which my normal tax is higher than AMT. In that year, I will deduct that AMT credit that you must have studied. It was just a small recap of that point. Compute the tax liability of Mr. Shan if he opt for the provision of 115 BAC. Now understand, if you opt for 115 BAC, the slab rate will change, but the total income will also change. Na? While calculating total income as per 115 BAC, I can't take standard deduction of salary. I can't take SOP ka interest. I can't take ATC ka deduction. ATC to ATU entirely I can't take, but ATJJAA is allowed. Achha, AMT ka concept is also not applicable if I'm following 115 BAC. So what I have to do? The total income as per old regime, I have to add back this deduction to arrive at the total income of 115 BAC. Now the total income as per old regime over here, 25,9,150. In that I will add back 50,000 standard deduction, house property loss 1,50,000, ATC ka deduction 1,50,000. So my total income as per 115 BAC comes to 28,59,150 only. On this I only have to apply normal tax regime, AMT is not applicable. Let me remind you the slab rate of 115 BAC, up to 2,50,000 0. 250 to 5,5%, that is 12,500. 5 lakh to 7.5 lakh 10%, that is 25,000. 7.5 lakh till 10 lakh 15%, that is 37,500. 10 lakh to 12 lakh 50,000 15%, that is 50,000. Then further if we go ahead, that is 1250 to 15 lakh, it will be 25%, 62,500. And whatever is the tax over and above 15 lakh, on that I have to apply 30%, that is 4,077,545. On that ultimately 4% health and education cess will be added. Final tax as per 115 BAC comes to 619050. So it will be 619060 accordingly. Rounded off on a higher side I have to do. So finally the tax payable is, answer is what? D. And the fifth point, the answer will be what? D. Are you understanding this? Then the very next question, that is a separate one. Mr. Kashyap is a CEO of Shai Limited. Purchased a BMW of 1.15 crore on 23rd September 2019 for his personal purpurpose. On 20th February 2023, he sold this car for Rs. 1 crore and incurred an expenditure of 2.74 lakh for transferring the ownership of a car. Compute the taxable capital gain or capital loss. When capital gain is attracted, when there is a capital asset should be transferred. Definition of capital asset given in section 2 clause 14. What is capital asset? Property of any kind, whether or not related to business. But it excludes something. What it excludes? Inventory is not a capital asset. Personal movable asset is also not a capital asset. Motor car is a personal movable asset. If it was for a business, then it would have formed part of block of asset. But this is though for personal use. Any personal motor car is not a capital asset. On transferring the same, no capital gain, no capital loss. Answer is nil. So sixth answer is nil because it is not a capital asset. Mr. Sunil has filed his return of loss for assessment year 22-23 on 31st July 2022. Received a total refund of rupees 44,500. So refund was 44,500. On 15th September 23, he would like to furnish his updated return of income for additional income. In case he furnished his updated return for additional income, he would be liable to pay 57,000 toward tax and 6,700 towards interest for this additional income to be reported in updated return. Means now refund is not there. Instead, you have to pay the tax 57,000. And how much interest along with that? 6,700. So total 63,700 you have to pay now. You have to pay this much. Okay. Compute the additional income payable by Mr. Sunil at the time of filing his updated return. First of all, updated return section 139 clause 8A. You can file any updated return up to 2 years from end of assessment year. However, if you file it up to 1 year from end of assessment year, then in that case you have to pay 25% of additional income tax. If you file after first year but before second year of assessment year, then you have to pay 50% of additional income tax. Here your assessment year is 22-23 and you are ready to file your updated return on 15 September 23. Can I say it is within 1 year from end of assessment year? And because of that, additional income tax you have to pay is 25% of that addition. How much is addition? 63,700 though you are paying. Further now refund also you have to repay back. So 44,500 also you have to repay back. Na? So total additional tax which you are supposed to pay now is 1,08,200. That is the total additional tax from the refund till tax payable. Total difference is 108,200. Of this 25% you have to pay additionally, which is 27,050. Answer has to be A. Then, XYZ Limited is engaged in manufacturing of mobile phones with a brand name Just Say. There are 5 dealers in Delhi and Mumbai to sell Just Say mobile phones. A Limited, a dealer in Delhi, receives 2 mobile phones and X Limited, who is a dealer in Mumbai, receives 1 mobile phone from XYZ Limited in January 23 on achieving the sales target in the third quarter. So basically, A Limited is receiving 2 mobile phones. And the X Limited in Mumbai is receiving only 1 mobile phone. Okay. The manufacturing cost of such mobile phone is 15,000 while the MRP is 25,000. The price charged from the customer for such mobile phone is after 22% of MRP. Is XYZ Limited liable to deduct any TDS of A Limited and X Limited? If yes, how much? First of all, for attracting TDS, we have to see which kind of income is being generated. For A Limited and X Limited, can't I say that they are receiving some additional benefit or perquisite from their supplier? Any additional benefit or perquisite received from supplier is taxable under the head PGBP as per section 28. And whenever this kind of benefit or perquisite, either in cash or in kind, if given to this kind of supplier, the person who is paying this kind of benefit will deduct TDS under section 194R, a newly added section from 1st July 2022. So 194R, whenever any benefit or perquisite is being given to any kind of supplier or dealer, 194R TDS is attracted, provided total value of benefit or perquisite should be more than 20,000 and the TDS to be deducted at the rate of 10%. Who is supposed to deduct TDS? Every person who is not an individual HUF or individual HUF whose last year turnover of business was more than 1 crore and if profession then more than 50 lakhs. Same like 194A, C, H, I, J. Here the company is giving the benefit. Compulsory 194R is attracted. But R is attracted only when the value of the benefit is more than 20,000. Then on entire benefit 10% is the rate of TDS. Question arises, sir, how to value that benefit? While explaining 194R in the classroom, I have said that some CBDT circular is there which I have recorded for May 23 statutory update. If you will see the video of May 23 statutory update, you will find some notes on 193R. It is available on JKC YouTube channel. Now on that, it has been clearly said that if any benefit is given which is in kind, then how much will be the value of benefit? If you would have sold to your customer what you would have charged, that much will be the value of benefit for this persons. Now if this mobile phone would have been sold to the customer, we would have charged 25,000 minus 22%. So 25,000 minus 22%, we would have charged 19,500 from one customer. To A Limited, we are giving two mobiles. Means how much in total benefit we are giving? 39,000, which is more than 20,000. So on this 39,000, 10% TDS, that is 3900 TDS of A Limited. To X Limited, only one mobile phone is giving, which is 19,500 value, which is less than 20,000. That means no TDS at all. And that's why the answer is 3900 from A Limited, no TDS from X Limited. Answer is what? A. Manufacturing cost is not to be seen. Earlier they have said see the manufacturing cost. Now they are saying see the value which you would have charged from your customers. So that's why we are looking at this value, 19,500. And that was a beautiful MCQ on 194R. Now some additional questions, that is descriptive one. A good question they have drafted on residential status and set of carry forward mix. Miss Asha is an Indian citizen. She is a lawyer by profession. She started her consultancy profession in India in 2019 with the name New Way Associates. In May 2021, that is last year, she got married to Mr. Ram, who is an American citizen. Mr. Ram came to India for the first time on 1st May 2020. So here Asha, here Ram. Ram came to India on 1st May 2020 when he joined a MNC in India. He got a promotion and transferred to Dubai. So he left for Dubai on 1st October 2021. He left on 1st October 21. Mrs. Asha accompanied him to Dubai. So even Asha also left India on 1st October 2021. Mrs. Asha started providing consultancy there now. Both of them came to India only for 3 months from June to August in 2022 to spend time with Asha's family. So let us assume 1st June till 31st August. So June 30 days, July 31 days, June, July and August again 31 days. So total 92 days Asha is also coming into India for the year 22-23 and Mr. Ram is also coming for 92 days in the year 22-23. But understand, there is one difference. Asha is Indian citizen. Ram is American citizen. Okay. Following is the income of Ram and Asha. We need to compute residential status of Ram and Asha and then their total income. Ignoring 115 BAC. First of all, let us think about Asha. Now, so far as Asha is concerned, she is an Indian citizen. She left India last year and now she is coming to India for visit purpose. So can I say for the year 22-23, she is said as an Indian citizen coming to India for visit. If she satisfy 182 days ka criteria, then to she will be resident. But if she do not satisfy 182 days ka criteria, then we have to see how much is her Indian income. Indian income meaning thereby income which accrued in India or received in India or controlled in India. If her Indian income is more than 15 lakhs, then we have to see whether she satisfy 120 days during the year plus 365 days in preceding 4 previous year. If yes, then she will be RBNOR. If no, then she will be non-resident. So again, any Indian citizen coming to India for visit purpose, first we have to check 182 days. If satisfied, then resident. If not satisfied, then we have to check Indian income. If more than 15 lakh, then check 120 plus 365 days. If satisfied, then directly RBNOR. If not satisfied, non-resident. If Indian income less than or equal to 15 lakh, then also directly what? Non-resident. Now here, she is covered under this exception. Stay in India during the year 22-23 is only 92 days, which do not satisfy 182 days ka criteria. So now we have to check Indian income. Now what is the income given for Asha? Profit from consultancy profession in Dubai, which is set up in India, not liable to tax in Dubai. Now, any income which is controlled from India, it is also called as Indian income so far as this 15 lakh wala criteria is concerned. See, while this 15 lakh wala criteria we are looking at, we have to see Indian income. Indian income means those income which are either accrued in India or received in India or controlled, yani set up in India. So, if any income is set up in India, that means it is controlled from India. It is called as Indian income. So, let us consider this 12 lakh rupees as of now. Profit from consultancy profession in India, this is accrued in India. So, even this 3 lakh is also called as Indian income. Long-term capital gain on sale of shares of British company credited to her Dubai bank account. Now, this is not accrued in India, not received in India. It is not Indian income. Short-term capital loss on sale of listed share of Indian company 42,000. This is, related to India. But we cannot set off capital loss against PGBP income. So, my Indian income is as of now 15 lakh. Not more than 15 lakh. It is less than or equal to 15 lakh. I will be directly called as non-resident. I don't have to check 120 plus 365 days. I will be called as non-resident. Now, if a person is a non-resident in India, how much income is taxable in India, which is either accrued in India or received in India? Something which is controlled from India only, that is taxable to RBNOR, not taxable to NR. She is NR. But sir, earlier you said na 12 lakh is to be included. Arre beta, that 12 lakh is to be included to check that 15 lakh wali limit. In that, accrued or received or controlled, three things are to be checked. But if ultimately that Indian income is less than or equal to 15 lakh and now you are called as non-resident, then again we have to calculate what is the total income as a non-resident. As a non-resident, only four kind of income is taxable in India. Accrued in India, deemed accrued in India, received in India, deemed received in India. So this 12 lakh rupees which is merely controlled from India, set up in India, that is not taxable to non-resident. But this consultancy profession in India is rupees 3 lakh. That is taxable in India. So, first income of Asha will be rupees 3 lakh. Because she is non-resident, the first income which will tax is rupees 3 lakh. Then, long-term capital gain on sale of shares of British company credited in Dubai bank account, accrued outside India, received outside India, not taxable to non-resident. Short-term capital loss, it is related to Indian company, but capital loss cannot be set off against PGBP income. It can be only set off against capital gain income. So this 42,000 I can't set off, and hence total income will be rupees 3 lakh. And the residential status what we have decided is what? Non-resident. Remind where? Less than or equal to 15 lakh is there. Now so far as Ram is concerned, Ram is American citizen. American citizen coming to India is do not covered by that exception. For that American citizen, either 182 days during the year or 60 days during the year plus 365 in preceding 4 previous year, that is the normal basic condition. So here he stayed in India during the previous year for 92 days, which is not satisfying 182 days. However, can I say more than or equal to 60 days satisfied? So now see what are the days for preceding 4 years. In preceding 4 years he was there in India from 1st May 2020 till 1st October 2021. That is full 1 year, 365 days, plus May month of 21, plus June, plus July, plus August, plus September, plus 1 day of October. That becomes 549 days somewhere. More than or equal to 365. And hence why this Ram becomes resident. But now RNOR or RBNOR, ordinary resident or but not ordinary resident, for that too we have to check additional condition. Acha, both additional conditions satisfied, then RNOR, otherwise RBNOR. However, if you observe, then the second additional condition is minimum 730 days in last 7 years. He was staying only for 549 days, which do not satisfy 730 days ka criteria. So Ram becomes RBNOR. He is now RBNOR. To RBNOR, 5 kind of income is taxable in India. Accrued in India, deemed accrued in India, received in India, deemed received in India, or controlled from India. That is taxable to RBNOR, not taxable to NR. Now for Mr. Ram, what are the income? Salary income from company in Dubai. Not liable to tax in Dubai, I don't care. This is not taxable in India, as it accrued outside India, received outside India. Long-term capital gain on sale of shares of Indian company, that is deemed accrued in India, section 9, 250,000 will be taxable to Mr. Ram in India. Further, income from house property in Delhi, it is computed, 30% is already deducted. As the house property is in Delhi, that rental income deemed to accrue or arise in India, 460,000 is also taxable in India. Dividend from share of Indian company, it is also deemed to accrue or arise in India, section 9, even the 65,000 taxable in India, total income will be 775,000. And residential status will be resident but not ordinarily resident. Are you understanding this? A very good question on residential status, on that 15 lakh wala point and on scope of income. Then, the next question says discuss correct or incorrect. Okay. Mr. Akash, aged 17 years, can I say he's a minor, received 350,000 as educational scholarship from Messrs. ABC Limited as a part of public welfare program. ABC Limited gave the above scholarship for his exceptional performance in higher secondary examination and to meet the cost of further studies. Section 10, Clause 16. Any scholarship given by anybody to meet the further cost of education, totally exempted from income tax. So this 350,000 is exempted from income tax. The scholarship so received by Akash is taxable in his hand under IFOS. The statement is totally incorrect. Why it is incorrect? Because under 10 clause 16, this income is exempt. Messrs. XY and Company, a partnership firm, is engaged in the business of operating goods vehicle and compute its income on presumptive basis under 44AE. Now, when you follow 44AE, 7500 per month per vehicle or 1000 per ton per month per vehicle, that is the deemed presumptive income if you have up to 10 goods carriage. However, you cannot get any kind of deduction. You cannot get any kind of disallowances. But you can get one deduction, even though you are opting 44AA, and that is partner's remuneration and partner's interest. This benefit is not there in 44AD or 44ADA. In that, this remuneration and interest deduction is not allowed. However, when you follow 44AE, partner's remuneration and partner's interest is allowed as a deduction, apart from this income. Since the income is computed under 44AE, no further deduction of any kind is allowable under income so computed. The statement is incorrect. One deduction is available, and that is partner's remuneration and partner's interest. And for that, the book profit will come, 40 clause B. Okay, but that is available. Then, cash credit of ₹1,50,000 were traced in the book of account of Mr. Yogesh. You know, cash credit, unexplained investment, unexplained income, unexplained expense, section 68, 69, 69A, 69B, 69C, 69D. Cash credit is a section of section 68, wherein a credit balance of loan something is there for which you can't give explanation. This is to be treated as your income on which tax rate is applicable as per section 115 BBE, 60% tax plus 25% compulsory surcharge plus 4% cess. 78% tax you have to pay. But what they are saying? For with this no explanation found, such income is taxed at 30% under 115 BBE. Again, this statement is incorrect. It is taxed under section 115 BBE and that too at the rate of 78%. Then, Mr. Shyam is a salaried individual. He purchased a painting and sculpture from his friend. Further, painting and sculpture, can I say it is a capital asset? Jewelry, archaeological collection, painting, drawing, sculpture, work of any art is a capital asset. So basically, he purchased capital asset from his friend Mr. Kamal and Mr. Ashish for 45,000 and 35,000 respectively. So what is the total movable property? See, these are movable property. Movable property he has purchased for rupees. What is the actual consideration of both the properties? 80,000 in total, even though two different person, but it is same category, na, movable property purchased. So total you have purchased for 80,000, whereas the fair market value is 80,000 and 60,000 respectively. So what is the fair market value of both the property? 1,40,000. So can I say you have purchased movable property with inadequate consideration? This belongs, both the asset belongs to same category, na, movable property purchased with inadequate consideration. How much inadequate consideration is there? 60,000. It is more than 50,000. and because the consideration, the difference is more than 50,000, entire 60,000 is taxable to the purchaser, Mr. Shyam, under IFOS gift income, section 56, subsection 2, clause 10. 60,000 would be taxable under IFOS. Since the difference between FMV and consideration of painting does not exceed 50,000 individually, nothing will be taxed to Mr. Shyam. Again, the statement is incorrect. Here you don't have to see the limit of 50,000 per asset. It has to be seen per annum from any person together. Together it is exceeding 50,000 and hence 60,000 is taxable under IFOS to the purchaser as a gift income of 56 subsection 2 clause 10. Simple. All the statements were incorrect. Then question number 11. AB Light LLP consists two working partners, Mr. Anand and Mr. Beam, with 60% and 40% share respectively. As per the partnership deed, they are eligible for interest on capital at 15% per annum on their capital contribution of 15 lakh each and remuneration of 50,000 per annum to Anand and 40,000 per annum to Beam. The firm is engaged in manufacturing business. During the year ended on 31st March 23, the net profit as per P&L is 25,86,000 before deducting interest and remuneration, as well as before deducting the following. Before we move further, let me just clarify something which you might have forgotten. In PGBP chapter, generally we teach this, section 40 clause B. To a partnership firm, which include LLP also, whatever interest is paid to partners, deduction is maximum allowed at the rate of 12%. Whatever is remuneration is paid to partner, deduction is allowed, depends on book profit. What is the meaning of book profit? It is PGBP income, calculated PGBP income, before deducting remuneration. You just don't need to deduct remuneration, deduct everything else, including this interest also. Whatever is your PGBP income is called as book profit. But remember, they have said PGBP income before deducting remuneration. And PGBP income means section 28 to section 44 DB. So, while calculating this book profit, you can deduct unabsorbed depreciation because you know it is forming part of section 32. However, you cannot deduct brought forward business loss because it is not a part of PGBP chapter. It is section 72 afterwards. You can deduct it from your final PGBP income. You cannot deduct it while calculating book profit. So in book profit, I can deduct unabsorbed depreciation. I cannot deduct brought forward business loss. This we have already discussed. Now on this book profit, up to rupees 3 lakh, if your book profit is up to 3 lakh, in total 90% of the book profit remuneration you can give maximum to the partner. And whatever is the book profit over and above 3 lakh, on that extra book profit, 60% of book profit can be given as a remuneration. However, this total remuneration cannot exceed, the actual remuneration which you are giving to your partners. Now over here, current year revenue expense on scientific research, which is dealt with by section 35. Unabsorbed capital expenditure on scientific research relating to last year, which is again dealt with by section 35. Brought forward business loss of assessment year 14-15. Which assessment year is going on? 23-25. And this loss belongs to assessment year 14-15. So 14-15, 15-16, 16-17, 17-18, 18-19, 19-20, 20-21. Assessment year 21-22 was the last year. Because brought forward business loss can be continued for 8 years. Today is assessment year 23-24. We cannot deduct this brought forward loss even from the book profit, even from the final income also we can't deduct. Unabsorbed depreciation dealt with by section 32. Now unabsorbed depreciation can be carry forwarded for infinite life. In that you don't have to see that 8 year ka criteria. Current year depreciation, that is so obviously to be deducted first. Brought forward business loss of assessment year 18-19. Now this is within 8 years. We can deduct. But we cannot deduct from book profit. We can deduct from our total PGBP income. Current year capital expenditure on scientific research, again section 35. You are required to compute total income after considering the above items. Also determine the amount of remuneration which is taxable in the hands of Anand and Beam individually. First, let us think about the firm. First, we have to calculate book profit. Based on that, we can calculate how much remuneration can be maximum deductible. Then we can reach to our PGBP income. For deducting book profit, we have to basically calculate our PGBP income, but before deducting remuneration, before deducting brought forward business loss. Now, what is the net profit given? 25,86,000. What first I can deduct? Interest given to partners. But maximum I can deduct 12%. Now their capital contribution is 15 lakh each. So both partner in together is having the capital of 30 lakh. On that maximum interest I can deduct is at the rate of 12%, which will be 3,60,000. What more I can deduct? Everything which is related to business except brought forward business loss. So I can deduct this 240, yes. I can deduct this 85,000, yes. I can deduct this 52,000, yes. I can deduct current rate appreciation, yes. I cannot deduct brought forward business loss as of now because I am calculating book profit. I can deduct even this current year capital expenditure also, because if you are having any scientific research in-house activity, then though you can claim any revenue expenditure, any capital expenditure, then depreciation is not there. But sir, here current year depre is given na. Arre beta, this current year depre can be related to any other asset. Does not necessarily for this asset na. So we can deduct that also. So how much I can further deduct from my book profit? 2,40,000 plus 85,000 plus 52,000 plus 4,70,000 plus 3,45,000. 11,92,000 I can deduct further. So what is my book profit now? My book profit is 10,34,000. If I see over here, my book profit that they have calculated is what? 10,34,000. Up to 3,90%. Above 3,00,000, whatever is the balance book profit of that 60%. If I apply that, maximum remuneration which can be deducted is 7,10,400. But see, how much remuneration you are giving to your partners in reality? To Anand, you are giving 50,000 per month. 50,000 per month, in short, full 6,00,000. To Mr. Bhim, you are giving 40,000. So for a year, you are giving 4,80,000. Total, you are giving 10,80,000. Maximum deduction can be possible 7,10,400. So as per section 40 clause B, I can deduct only 7,10,400. So how much final PGBP income is there? 3,23,600. Now from this, I can deduct brought forward business loss of assessment year 18,19,49,000. So finally, my income will be 274,600 on that directly 30% tax plus 4% surcharge. Now the question is, how much remuneration is taxable to the partner? Remuneration interest is always taxable to the partner under the head PGBP. How much taxable? So first of all, only that much taxable which is allowed as a deduction to the partnership firm. How much deduction partnership firm has taken? Partnership firm has taken a deduction of rupees 7,10,400. So to both the partner combinedly, 7,10,400 is the maximum amount which is taxable. Arre, but how much will be taxable to Anand? How much taxable to Bhim? It depends on how much remuneration you are giving, 6,00,000 and 4,80,000. So divide this into the ratio of 6:4.8. That is 6,00,000 is to 4,80,000. So in proportion to Anand, how much remuneration comes? So it comes to 3,94,667. That much will be taxable to Anand. And balance will be taxable to Bhim in the ratio of their actual remuneration. But what is the maximum remuneration that is taxable? 7,10,400, which is taxable to the partnership firm. What is disallowed to the partnership firm? You can't again tax to partner. It will lead to double taxability. And that's why only that much will be taxable, which was allowed as a deduction to partnership firm. A very wonderful question they have drafted, combining, you know, section 35 wala point, partners remuneration wala point, set of carry forward chapter wala point, which is generally not given in module. Provisions are all covered. But this kind of question is something unique where you have to apply extra mind. So that was a good question. Then determine capital gain or capital losses and the tax liability also, assuming you do not have any other income. First case, on 12th December 22, 1200 shares of X Limited, a listed company, are sold by Mr. Vishal, who is a non-resident, at the rate 1550 per share, and STT was paid at the time of sale of share. These shares were acquired by him on 25th May 2017 for 425 per share by paying STT at that time. First of all, when you sell any kind of listed shares, and if it is long term, that is for more than 12 months, then you are selling 112A. Above 1,00,000, 10% will be the tax rate. However, if those listed share on which STT paid at the time of sale and purchase both, then to determine what is the cost of acquisition, section 55 subsection 2 clause AC will come into the picture. What this section says, if the shares were purchased on or after 1st February 2018, the cost is actual cost. But if these shares were acquired prior to 1st February 18, then what is the cost of acquisition? The cost of acquisition is step number 1. Fair market value on 31st January 2018 or the full value of consideration, whichever is lower. Step number 2 says, step number 1 or actual cost, whichever is higher. Now what is to be counted as fair market value? The highest price on stock market, the highest price on 31st January 18 is to be counted as fair market value. So they have given the value related to 31st January 18, on that highest price is 618. So fair market value is 680. The full value of consideration for which you are selling that is given 1550. Whichever is lower, 680. Now 680 or actual cost, what was your actual cost? 425. Whichever is higher, 680. So my cost of acquisition will become 680 per share. The full value of consideration is 1550. So what is the capital gain? By the way, when 112A is applicable for listed share above 1,10%, indexation benefit is not available in cost of acquisition. So we can't index this. So my capital gain is now 870 per share. How much share I have sold? 1200 shares. So basically, how much long-term capital gain is attracted to me? The capital gain which is attracted to me is rupees 10,44,000. 10,44,000 is the capital gain which is attracted. On that, no other income is there. So can I say my total income is 10,44,000? Now 2 points, my general income and special income. What is my special income? Section 112A. Pura 10,44,000. What is my general income? Zero. So can I say the limit of 2,50,000, that is the basic exemption limit, is getting wasted, which I can deduct from the special income as a shifting benefit? No. The person is a non-resident. Shifting benefit is not available to non-resident. It is only applicable to resident. I can't deduct this basic exemption limit. I directly have to calculate the tax. Above 1,10%. So because in 112A it is written up to 1,00,000, more than that 10%. So 9,44,000 into 10% will lead to 94,400 plus 4% health and education says my tax payable 98,176 rounded off to 98,180. 98,180 will become my tax payable. Then Mr. Kabir, a resident aged 45 years, is the owner of a residential house which was purchased on 1st August 2020 for rupees 19 lakh. That is a capital asset. He sold the said house on 25th September 2022 for a building. 24 months is the period of holding. I am selling this house property after 24 months and hence it is called as long-term capital asset. Indexation benefit is available. You sold for 24,50,000, but valuation as per stamp duty authority is 25,50,000. Section 50C, if your stamp duty value is more than 110% of actual value, if your stamp duty value is more than 110% of actual value, then stamp duty value will become your full value of consideration. Here, my full value of consideration is what? 24,50,000. So basically, stamp duty value is 25,50,000, actual sale value is 24,50,000. 24,50,000 ka 110% is 26,95,000, whereas stamp duty value is 25,50,000, which is less than 110% of actual value, and hence I don't need to take stamp duty value as my full value of consideration. It will be the actual value. What is actual value? 24,50,000. So my full value of consideration will become 24,50,000. From that I will deduct index cost of acquisition, because this is a long term capital asset. So the cost is 19 lakh into 331 divided by 301. My index cost is 20,89,369. So long term capital gain, which is the only total income, 366,31 rounded off to 366,30. Now understand, here the person is resident. Total income is 360. Yes, 360, 630, sorry. 360, 630. So I have to divide into two parts, general income, special income. General income is zero, special income is taxable under 112. Any other long-term capital asset, long-term capital gain, 20% is the tax rate under section 112. That is 360, 630. But against that, shifting benefit is available to resident. Whether this person is a senior citizen, no. So shifting benefit of 2,50,000 is attracted. After deducting this shifting benefit, 360, 630 minus 2,50,000. My income is remaining 110, 630. Of that, 20% is the basic tax. 20% will become 22,126. Can I say my total income is less than or equal to 5 lakh? I am a resident individual. Rebate under section 87A is attracted, which you will definitely forget in exam. Maximum rebate is 12,500. So how much basic tax is remaining now? 9,626. On that, ultimately, I have to add 4% health and education cess. 10011 rounded off to 10010. This is the tax payable finally. Are you understanding this? Then, Mr. Jain, a resident individual aged 40 years, suffers from severe disability as certified by medical authority. First of all, he is a resident person. Suffering from severe disability, deduction under section 80U is available. But what is the maximum deduction of 80U? Severe disability means more than 80%. 1,25,000 is the fixed deduction that he will get. Now, after all the information, what they are asking? Compute total income if does not opt for 115 BAC. Wonderful. Now, here we need to calculate total income. One by one, let us read this. Whatever we'll find, we'll tick in the answer. First of all, I told you that 80U deduction will be 1,25,000. So let's tick that 1,25,000 80U ka deduction. Then, he has paid life insurance premium by check for 27,000 to insure his life. Insurance policy was taken on 27th August 2018. Sum assured is rupees 2,20,000. Understand. In 80C, maximum deduction is 1,50,000. But for life insurance premium, that is an internal limit also, na? 10% of sum assured. But if the person is suffering from 80U ka disability, then 15% of sum assured. Here is suffering from disability. Sum assured is 2,20,000. So maximum deduction can be taken up to 15%, which is 33,000. He paid only 27,000. 80C ka deduction will be available, rupees 27,000. Then, he had written a literacy book for Rochak publication. A lump sum amount of royalty earned during the year 9 lakh. Expense incurred is 40,000. Royalty. Taxable 9 lakh minus 40,000. That is 8,60,000. 8,60,000 is IFOS income because it is not said it is business. However, for a resident individual, any royalty which is received, 80QQB, royalty for the book which is authored by him, 80QQB is the deduction. Is it lump sum royalty? So maximum deduction is rupees 3 lakh. 80QQB, deduction of rupees 3 lakh. Here though they are not asking for tax payment. But if they would have asked us to calculate tax payable, I would have thought about alternate minimum tax also. Because 80QQB is also one of the section because of which alternate minimum tax comes. But here though they are not asking for tax payable, so I am fine for that. His friends gifted a statue of Goddess Saraswati to his daughter Miss Dia, aged 14 years, on the successful completion of her secondary school. Fair market value of the statue is 65,000. Can I say it is one kind of painting, drawing, archaeological collection, sculpture, work of any art? It is a capital asset which has been received as a gift. Gift is received by minor daughter. Now, whatever is the income of minor, apart from special skill, talent, etc., any other income is to be clubbed in the hands of parent. Let us assume that here Mr. Jain ka income is more than Mrs. Jain ki income. So all the income of minor will be clubbed in the hands of Mr. Jain. As the gift is of rupees more than 50,000, movable property received without consideration, value is more than 50,000, 65,000 will be taxable under IFOS. But as it is the minor ka income, 1500 exemption is available under section 10 clause 32. Because he is following old system. If he is following 115 BAC, I would have not deducted 1500, but here I have to. So 65,000 minus 1500, that will be 63,500. So I have to add 63,500. Then he received gold chain worth 68,000 from in-laws on the occasion of marriage anniversary. See, section 56 subsection 2 clause 10. Gold chain is a jewelry. It is a capital asset. If more than 50,000 received, it is taxable. On the marriage anniversary, it is not marriage. However, it is received from in-laws, father-in-law or mother-in-law, that is lineal ascendant of spouse. As per the definition of relative under that section, lineal ascendant of spouse is also relative. And whatever gift you are receiving from relative, it is never taxable. And hence this gift is not taxable. He had deposited 70,000 in fixed deposit with SBI in the name of minor son. Interest earned is 5,500. Even this interest is also to be clubbed in the hands of Mr. Jain. This is son. Earlier it was a daughter. Separate child. So again 1500 exemption is available. So 5500 minus 1500. How much will be clubbed total? 4000 rupees will be clubbed. He donated 5000 in cash to NGO. The NGO is registered under 80G. This is a type 4 wala deduction. 50% of donation or 50% of the limit, whichever is lower. But I can't take the deduction because 80G says if more than 2000 donated in cash, no deduction is available. And hence I can't take the deduction because 5000 donated in cash, my 80G ka deduction will be zero. Then he had taken a loan of rupees 38 lakh for purchase of a house property, valuing 45 lakh for self-occupation from a financial institution on 1st May 2020. He repaid 1,80,000 during the year, out of which 1,05,000 is principal, so balance 75,000 is interest. For any SOP, net annual value is zero. What I can deduct? Interest on borrowed capital, because old regime is there. I fully 75,000 I can deduct against 24 clause B. As entire interest is deducted under 24 clause B, I don't have to think about 80EEB or 80EEA. 80EEA is not applicable because entire interest is covered by house property chapter itself. Acha, what principal I have repaid, that is allowed as a deduction under section 80C. So in 80C I have deducted 1,05,000. So see, total gross total income is 850 to 500, 80C ka deduction, 80QQB, 80U, total income is 295,500. And that is what my answer is. Then 14th question, a wonderful question. Mrs. Kashish, a resident individual, aged 62 years, mind well, she is a resident senior citizen, qualified medical practitioner. She runs her own clinic. Income and expenditure is as under. See, the full P&L is given. Income is there, expense is there, and some adjustment is there. First, what is asked? You are required to compute total income and tax liability of Kashish, assuming she is not opting for 115 BAC, old regime. While calculating total income, first always follow under PGBP chapter. First always solve PGBP and then any other head. PGBP answer always start with net profit. Here the net profit is 55,34,000. So let us start the head PGBP by 55,34,000. Now I always tell in the lecture that this kind of sums always needs to be solved in reverse U manner. First you give treatment for credit side, then you give treatment for adjustment, then you come for debit side. First let us go to credit side. Consultancy fee 74,28,000. Please understand, she is a doctor, specified profession. Consultancy income is more than 50 lakh. She can't opt for 44 ADA. I can't directly declare 50% as a PGBP income. I have to calculate as per normal provision. But consultancy income is a business income. It is credited in the P&L. I don't need to do anything further. Salary received from True Care Hospitals Private Limited, 10,80,000. It is a salary income. It don't have to do anything under PGBP. Let us deduct from PGBP. Acha, what to be added in salary, we'll see later on. As of now, focus on PGBP. Rental income from house property, 2,40,000. Again, this is an income of house property, but wrongly credited to P&L. Deduct the same from PGBP. Dividend from foreign company gross, 60,000. Again, this is an income related to IFOS. Dividend is compulsory IFOS income. So 60,000 to be deducted. And in IFOS, I will add 60,000 because it is a deemed IFOS income. So 60,000 rupees will be added. Then let us see the adjustment. She is working part-time with True Care Hospitals Private Limited and salary income is as under. First of all, this entire thing is related to salary. As of now, we are solving PGBP. Let us keep it pending for salary chapter. Then she owns a residential house. The reconstruction was started on blah blah blah. Can I say this entire related to house property chapter? Even this I will do later on. As of now, focus should be only on PGBP. Other information. Conveyance expense. If you see your P&L on debit side, there is a conveyance expense 1,44,000. They say it include a sum of 48,000 incurred for the conveyance from house to True Care Hospitals Private Limited, which is in relation to employment. It is not in relation to your business. So this 48,000 is not a business expenditure. It is to be completely disallowed. 48,000 to be added back, wrongly debited to P&L. Power and fuel expense, which is debited in the P&L, include a sum of rupees 10,000 incurred for generator fuel for providing power back to the tenant. Now this is somewhat house property or IFOS kind of stuff. It should not be debited to your business P&L, and that's why this 10,000 is to be added back. From where it is to be deducted, we'll see later on. Administrative expense include a sum of 10,000 paid as municipal tax of her house. Now whatever is the municipal tax of house to be deducted from house property chapter. As of now we are doing PGBP, and that's why 10,000 is to be added back. But remember, in house property you have to deduct. Clinic equipment details, which is given obviously for depreciation. How much depreciation is debited in the P&L? Oh, no depreciation. So can I say I can't take depreciation? No, as per section 32 it is compulsory to take. Opening WDV is 5 lakh. So let us assume this opening WDV means last year ka WDV minus last year ka depreciation, that is 5 lakh. A fresh purchase is done 20th August for 75,000, that is more than 180 days, but it was paid in cash. What section 43 subsection 1 ka proviso says? If any capital asset for which the payment is done in a single person to a single on a single day exceeding 10,000 otherwise than by account pay check, account pay draft, ECS or other electronic mode, you can't take depreciation on that. I can't add this 75,000 as it is paid more than 10,000 in cash in a single day to a same person. On this depreciation is not available. It is only available on this 5 lakh. For full year, 15% depreciation, 75,000 depreciation I can deduct. Yes, 75,000. However, additional depreciation is also not applicable. Because she is a professional, additional depreciation toh can't be there. Okay. She also paid tuition fee 40,000 for granddaughter, which is debited to capital account. Understand, in 80C, tuition fee is allowed as a deduction only for child, not grandchild. So she can't take deduction for this tuition fee. She availed a loan of 25 lakh from a bank for higher education of her son, repaid principal 3 lakh and interest 1,56,000. As per section 80E, interest on education loan is allowed as a deduction even if it is taken for child. Interest on education loan, not principal. Interest is 1,56,000. Under section 80E, 1,56,000 will be deducted. Now let us see the debit side of P&L and what's wrong in that. We'll add back. Salary to staff, okay. Administrative expense, rent of the clinic, it is a business expense. Conveyance allowance, done with. Power and fuel, done with. Interest on housing loan, 2,20,000. Array, it is to be deducted from house property chapter. It can't be deducted from PGBP. Add back. 2,20,000 is to be add back. Then interest on education loan. Array, we have already deducted under 80E. So even 1,56,000 is to be added back. Amount paid to scientific research under section 35. Donation for scientific research is allowed as a deduction under 35. It is already debited to P&L. You don't need to add back. You don't need to deduct. It's already deducted. If she would have followed 115 BAC, I would have added back. Because in that donation is not allowed as a deduction. Here it is allowed. So let us keep it as it is. Can I say my entire PGBP ke sare adjustment is done? See, starting from the net profit, each and everything has a tick on this. And that's why I came on PGBP income, that is now crystallized. But now salary and house property spending na? Let us move to salary first of all, which is the very first adjustment. She's working with part-time with True Care Hospitals Private Limited. Even part-time job is called as a job. Salary is taxable under the head salary. Salary is basic pay 85,000 per month. So for this entire year, 10,20,000. Transport allowance 5,000 per month. Whether in this question they have said that this person is a handicapped person or disabled person suffering from any disability? No. It was there in earlier question, not in this question. So this transport allowance is completely taxable. It is deduction, exemption is only for a disabled person, not for a normal person. So 60,000 is even taxable. Further, during the year, her son has undergone a medical treatment in True Care Hospital Private Limited free of cost. Hospital would have charged 160 from another patient. Understand, this is a perquisite in relation to medical facility provided in India. But in that, it has been said as a proviso to Section 17, Clause 2. If the medical facility is provided to the employee or relatives, which include child, dependent or independent both, in any hospital which is owned by employer, it will not be called as perquisite. It will not be taxable. Can I say the son has undergone the surgery? That is the relative of employee. The hospital is owned by the employer. And in that case, this perquisite will not be taxable. So my gross salary is 10,80,000. From that, I will deduct 50,000 rupees ka standard deduction. So it will become 10,20,000 taxable under which head? Salary. Sorry, 1080 minus 50 becomes 1030. 10,30,000 will be taxable under which head? Salary. But sir, what about this conveyance expense? Beta, this conveyance expense can be deducted as an exemption when you are receiving conveyance allowance. You are not receiving conveyance allowance. So this can't be helpful while calculating salary income. So salary is done. Now house property. She owns a residential house. The reconstruction, that is one kind of repairs, started on 1st April 22, completed on 30th September 22. After the reconstruction, the ground floor is SOP, whereas the first floor is rented. And let us assume both are of equal area, that is written also. Rented from 1st October 22. So can I say 50% of the house is SOP? 50% of the house is let out property. Whatever is the portion of SOP, NAV will be zero, but interest can be deducted. Further, they have said the monthly rent is 40,000. The tenant also pay 3,000 per month as a power back charges. First of all, she gave the property on a rent from 1st October 22. So municipal value, fair rent, standard rent is not given. Expected rent is not there. Only actual rent will become gross annual value. For 6 months, how much rent is being collected? Total 43,000. But there is a concept called composite rent. Only house property related rent will come under LOP, house property. The remaining rent which is related to any other services will go under IFOS. So in GAV, I have to take only this 40,000 for 6 months. How much rent is there? 2,40,000. However, this 3,000 per month power back charges. So for 6 months, how much power back charges I would have received? 18,000. That will be taxable under IFOS. See, in IFOS, 18,000 will be taxed. Yes, but you remember in one adjustment they have given us the expenditure relating to power back charges 10,000. That is an expenditure. It is allowed as a deduction under section 57. So this 10,000 will be deducted. Balance 8,000 will become IFOS income. Again, come back to house property wherein the rental income is 2,40,000. Interest on housing loan from 1st April to 30th September is 120. From 1st October to 31st March is 1 lakh. Arre, I have to see the entire year ka interest. Entire year ka total interest is 2,20,000. But can I say from this 50% SOP, 50% LOP. So 1,10,000 belongs to SOP. 1,10,000 belongs to LOP. Now whatever belongs to SOP, this loan is regarding repairs or reconstruction. The limit under section 24 clause B is 30,000. So in SOP, I will get 30,000 ka loss. However, in LOP, I will deduct full 1,10,000. But that is later on. During the year, she also paid municipal taxes. For last year 5,000, for current year 5,000. Total, she paid 10,000. Municipal tax is allowed as a deduction on payment basis, irrespective of the year in which it accrued. I have paid total 10,000 ka municipal tax, 50% SOP, 50% LOP. Whatever is regarding SOP, I will get no deduction. Whatever is with regards to LOP, that 5,000 I will get as a deduction under house property. So my net annual value is 2,35,000. From that 2,35,000, 30% is the standard deduction and 1,10,000 is the full interest element belonging to LOP. So 2,35,000 minus 30% minus 1,10,000, that is 54,500. But 30,000 ka loss internally set off, finally I will get 24,500 as my house property income. Yes, 24,500, that is my house property income. Now see, this entire adjustment is taken care of. This adjustment is taken care of, municipal tax is taken care of, all deductions are taken care of, our entire question is taken care of. This salary income is done, house property is done, PGBP income is done, IFOS is also done, gross total income done, ATE ka deduction done, total income is 54,89,500. Now whether they have asked us to calculate tax liability, yes. Now while calculating this tax liability, can I say she is a senior citizen? So above 10 lakh on 44,89,500, 30% and plus 1,10,000, because up to 3 lakh there will be no tax. She is a senior citizen. Basic tax is 14,56,850 plus compulsory 10 taka surcharge because total income is now more than 50 lakh. After adding that, we have to think about marginal relief, but generally gap is 4 lakh. 50 lakh and total income has a gap of 4 lakh. So marginal relief will not come. Plus add 4% says final tax payable rounded off 16,66,640. Understand, there is no TDS deducted in this entire question. They have not said anything. In consultancy fee also gross net word is not used. Here also TDS not said anything. Rental income also no TDS. Here gross word is used. But when a foreign company is paying you dividend, section 194 TDS cannot come. It can come only when domestic company is paying you dividend. So foreign company must not have deducted your TDS, and that's why I will deduct no TDS from my tax payable. If instead of this word domestic company would have written, then I would have assumed that gross means on this 60,000 10% TDS, that is 6,000 would have been deducted. I would have reduced TDS of 6,000 from my tax payable. But in this question, the word is foreign income, foreign company, and that's why TDS will not be deducted. That was the end of the question. Last question. Who is authorized to verify the return of income in the following cases? Section 140 says that after filing of return, every person needs to verify the return. And there is a table also I have given even in my YouTube marathon that who is supposed to verify that. If HUF, first Karta will verify, but Karta is absent from India, then any adult member will verify, any either male or female. A company, then generally managing director. If no managing director, any other director. But if his company wound up and in liquidation, then liquidator will verify. Local authority, then the principal officer, which in layman sense we call mayor, that principal officer will verify. Individual who is mentally incapacitated for attending his affairs, then any legal guardian or authorized person on his behalf will verify. Are you understanding this? That was the end of RTP November 2023 inter CA. Please do all the provisions carefully, solve all the question of JKSE classwork, and ICI illustration exercise question is to be done must. This RTP obviously you are done with, and that's why you are hearing these lines what I'm saying. Mock test papers of ICI will also come, that also you need to solve. JKSE test series is going on, which you can never ignore, which you have to give at any given cost. Whatever doubts you are having, our helpline number is there, our live doubt solvings are there. We all the faculties are always ready to support you in any kind of doubts. Please reach us and solve your doubts. All the very best for your examination. Thank you so much.